Hi, welcome to Riverside Monthly. I'm Steve Brazel, and we have some great shows lined up for you this month. As always, for each and every show, I will be joined by the mayor for the city of Riverside, Mayor Patricia Locke Dawson. Madam Mayor, how are you?
I'm doing well, Steve. Thank you.
We've got great shows lined up for the audience this month. What are we going to be talking about?
Well, we have a guest from the Riverside Public Utilities who's going to talk to us about Don't Doubt the Drought, their campaign of awareness for folks to know that we are still in a drought.
Which is very fitting this time of year. Also, we're going to be talking to the founder and creator of the Magnolia Center Marketplace, happening every other Saturday, the first and third Saturdays of the month. We'll be talking to him.
And we have a guest academic who is going to talk to us about the 2022 Quality of Life Survey that we are going to be rolling out for residents of Riverside.
And this one is just a segment that I absolutely loved recording. I think you're going to enjoy it as well. We have a new employee here at the City of Riverside, Riverside's new Intergovernmental Relations Officer, and it's a conversation you're not going to want to miss. Where can people find you, Mayor, if they wanted?
Well, they can find us on social, at Twitter and Instagram at Mayor Locke Dawson, or on Facebook, City of Riverside hyphen, I guess.
Dash, okay.
Dash, Mayor Patricia Locke Dawson.
Okay, I love the at. We are joined this time around for this segment by a principal engineer for water engineering at Riverside Public Utilities. I'd like to welcome Leo Ferrando to the show. Leo, how are you?
Good morning. I'm doing really good. Thank you.
It's nice to have you here. It's your first time on the show.
First time ever, yes.
Oh, you're gonna have so much fun. Mayor, you want to get us going?
I do, because, you know, water is a subject after my own heart. I did study hydrological systems for my master's degree. So Leo and I were just chatting before. So this is really interesting to me. And I have to ask, so, you know, we're now in another drought, right? We're now in another drought, and it's pretty serious. But how does it compare to previous years of drought in Riverside?
Yes, we overall, you know, I would say that we're in a drought for over 15 years. We've had a couple of wet years in, say, 2011 and 2016, for example, where we received above normal rainfall, but every other year has been dry. And the difference is that now the last 3 years have been the driest years on record for our state.
Oh, wow.
And also the last 3 months, January, February, and March, have been the driest 3 months on record.
And those are our rainiest months usually, correct?
It's our rainy season, that's correct. Our winter is our rainy season.
So I hear a lot of times people say to me, throughout my life actually, having grown up in Riverside, you know, but we got a lot of rain last winter, so why are we still in a drought? And I don't think people really understand that getting a lot of rain for a particular period of time does not necessarily mitigate the effects of 15 years of drought. Could you kind of, you know, explain a little bit how rain relates to the drought condition that we might have?
Yes, so like I was saying, we are prepared here in the city of Riverside to meet all of our demands. However, the rain that we got, for example, this last December, even though it was considered an above normal rain for the month of December on a monthly basis, like I said before, we have been on the driest 3 months now, on going on four on record on our state. And so those dry 3 months really erased
everything.
The good rainfall that we were able to get in December, and the snowpack was pretty much gone by mid-March. So we need to have continuous rainfall throughout the state, and we need to maintain our snowpack in the Sierras to have, you know, a good, healthy water supply in our state.
Let me dive deeper on that really quick, because you just said something interesting to me, and that is the snowpack. So it's not just rain, but the snowpack is a critical part of this?
The snowpack is a critical part of this because it supplies water to the state, and the state supplies water to several agencies, 27 total, that we have. There's state water project, what we call, you know, that, you know, they supply the water to all those agencies. And, you know, In the city of Riverside, we are fortunate that we have our own local water supplies and we're able to meet demands, but also at the same time, we are the stewards of California water.
Right.
And we do want to use the water efficiently. And
well, and drought too, just to your point too, Stephen. My understanding is like it's year over year, right, with the snowpack. So, I mean, if snowpack has diminished and it's completely gone, it can't, trickle out and fill our coffers over the drier months. So if we don't get it, right, that's what causes the drought. So,
right.
I know. Hey, Leo, tell me though, so what can Riverside residents do to kind of lessen the impact of the drought? And even though we have our water supplies, as you mentioned, we have to be very mindful of our use. So what can Riverside residents do to do that? And then how can Riverside Public Utilities help? Where do they come in with that?
Well, what we can do is basically pretty much use common sense and
that's a big
try to.
I know, right?
And well, there's a few items that we can do is, for example, we have a little bit of rain last night, right? We received 0.2 inches. And so what we can do, for example, is turn off our sprinklers for the next 48 hours because our lawns really don't need it. We want to be good stewards of our environment and water our trees, but I think like turf or shrubs, whatever, we don't really need to be irrigating all of those all the time. So down to 3 times a week would work. Also, don't hose off your driveways, anything that really causes runoff and water to leave your property, that's something that we can do. Riverside Public Utilities, and if you go to riversidepublicutilities.com, you can get into rebates. We can help. You can get high-efficiency washing machines, high-efficiency toilets, and you can get rebates through that. You can fix your plumbing. Any leaks that you may have around the house, fix them right away and don't let them linger. So, and those types of things, really.
And I'll add to that along with water-efficient appliances that you can get for your house, I actually went and got a smart sprinkler controller. So last night I got a notification that water skip was activated because it saw the rain coming and it made it easy for it to just not water my lawn and save some water that way. So Leo, if people want to know more about the drought specifically, where can they go?
Well, people can go to the RiversidePublicUtilities.com website, RiversidePublicUtilities.com/drought.
Okay.
And there's information about the drought there. There's information about rebates, both indoor and outdoor. Indoors for high-efficiency toilets and washing machines, for example, and also for outdoor, like the smart sprinklers you just mentioned. We have rebates for those as well, turf replacement programs, those types of things. So people can explore and find out more on riversidepublicutilities.com/drought.
I appreciate your time so much. Again, I want to thank our guest, Principal Engineer for Water Engineering for Riverside Public Utilities, Leo Ferrando. Thanks for joining us. I hope you'll come back.
Thank you so much for having me.
Introducing Riverside Connect, a rideshare service for Riverside residents with disabilities or who are 60 years old or better. Service is available Monday through Friday from 8 a.m. to 5:30 p.m. and weekends and holidays from 9 a.m. to 4 p.m. Our one-way fares begin as low as $2 each way. Riverside Connect, connecting you to where you want to go. For more information, call 951-687-8080 or visit riv-connect.com.
Hi, once again, welcome to Riverside Monthly. I'm Steve Brazel. We've got 4 shows for you this month, and this segment is one near and dear to my heart because it's something that I've actually gone to a number of times. Saturdays at the Riverside Center Marketplace, as always, joined by the mayor for the city of Riverside, Mayor Patricia Locke Dawson. How are you?
Doing very well, Steve. Thank you for having me this morning.
Isn't this a beautiful time in Riverside?
It is lovely. I agree.
Love this time of year. We got a great segment for you. We're going to talk about Saturdays at the Magnolia Center Marketplace. And our guest this time around is the actual organizer of this for the Riverside Magnolia Center Marketplace, Rico Alderette. How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Good. It's nice to have you here. I love your hat.
Well, thanks for having us. Thank you.
Mary, you want to get us going?
Oh, I would love to, because Rico is a friend as well as an amazing businessman here in Riverside. And he got the Magnolia Marketplace started. And I'm just wondering, what was the motivation for that? And, you know, like, did you have goals set out for that? I mean, what made you get it started?
So when we opened up MADE, we saw that there was a MAG Center, which is the Magnolia Center, should have a bigger energy. So everybody's loving downtown, but no one loves MAG Center. So we're like, you know what? Let's do an event down here. Let's bring some traffic down here. And that was the intent, was to start helping the small businesses there get a little traffic, put this little MAG Center on the map right next to the plaza.
Yeah, and this marketplace is on Sunnyside, right there down by the Riverside Plaza. And I've been a number of times. I've got a friend's band who plays there, and I go see them play there too. But as a business owner, you just mentioned MADE, which is just around the corner on Magnolia, right?
Correct.
So as a business owner in the Magnolia Center area, what has something like this done for the residents, for the business owners? What has the reaction been from those two groups?
So when we started the market, there was a little backlash from the local businesses.
Really?
And it was weird to me because, like, we bring over 1,000 people a night now down there. And,
wow, I didn't know it had grown that big. Holy cow.
So, and then the store is around the corner. So we're not even on the strip. But as we brought it in, they're like, oh, well, I don't know, we're going to lose parking and this and that. But everybody who's been there since the beginning and has started, we've gotten a lot of positive response from it. There are a few businesses that don't stay open during it and things like that, which I believe they don't capitalize on the benefits of it. But even the plaza, I believe, even has a burst in sales and everything. So it really brings people down. So there's, on the majority, there's a big positive vibe on it.
A lot of the people that go, by the way, I will tell you, because I've done this where I'm driving down intending to go to the plaza, and I see it right there and go, oh, that's right, marketplace is tonight.
Yeah, it's also, I think, really important in a time when anything we want around the world is from the touch of a button, right? Anybody can order, and the pandemic, I mean, saw a lot of that, right? So online marketplaces are booming. So, I mean, I think it's more important more now than ever to be able to have local.
I'm biased obviously on that a little bit, but I think that when you spend your money here, when anybody buys anything from the store, buys anything at the market, though, all those vendors, there's 80 plus vendors there, you're giving them money to spend here locally. And it's just kind of, I'm not an economist by any means, but it seems like if you spend the money here, I go to my barber here, I shop here locally, all the money stays here, and all the profits stay here. And it just helps the community. Well, the rising tide lifts all ships. So I don't think a lot of people understand the importance, and I guess we'll side tangent on that, the importance of spending local. It's enormous.
It's not only the tax revenue, but it's also that you're giving somebody money as a vendor, right?
Right.
The people that are selling, they're able to now have money that they can spend locally too. So it's really a multiplicative effect.
Well, plus we all have jobs here. And when I support you, you then take the money that you earn and you give it to the business that I work for or own or whatever the case might be. And so as a community, you're supporting your neighbors and your friends and people's brothers and sisters that work at or own these businesses. It's so important. If people want to know more specifically about the Magnolia Center Marketplace, where can they go?
They can go to magnoliacentermarketplace.com.
It's that easy.
We have all of our dates on there. We have vendors' information on there. One thing we didn't put out, we got a beer garden this year. We have buskers come out, music. It's at over 80 local or 80 vendors. And it's a good, fun time.
What months does it go through? Because it's only certain months out of the year, correct?
We go April to October. We really don't want to try and pull away from the Festival of Lights, so we're like, we'll shut off during that time.
And it's the first and third?
First and third Saturday.
First and third Saturday.
So every other Saturday, first and third. You know, one thing we didn't do, if you were to give somebody a helicopter view of what is the Magnolia Center Marketplace, how would you describe it to somebody?
You'd have...
And understand this is your time to get more than 1,000 people down there.
you'd see from the bird's eye view, you'd see a decent-sized beer garden with local brewers. You'd see a big street with all kinds of food and tents lined up all the way down the line. Food, handmade jewelry, all kinds of different vendors there. And people having a really, really good time.
Yeah.
And we're pet-friendly.
That's important.
Yeah. And it's just such a fun thing. So again, check out the Magnolia Center Marketplace. MagnoliaCenterMarketplace.com is the website. Rico Alderette, thank you so much for coming down, man. I appreciate it.
Thank you guys for having us.
We are proud of the Riverside Police Department's tradition of integrity, service, and excellence. RPD officers are disciplined, well-trained professionals who always lean forward to make our community safer and more livable. We are always looking for mature, educated men and women who want to apply their courage and judgment to serve the people of Riverside. If that's who you are, we want to talk to you.
Hi, welcome to another episode of Riverside Monthly. I'm Steve Brazel, your host. We've got a great episode lined up for you this time around. In fact, we've got four great episodes this month. Be sure to check out each and every one, and please do share them with your friends. I'm joined, as always, by the mayor for the city of Riverside, Mayor Patricia Locke Dawson. Mayor, how are you?
I'm doing very well, Steve. Thank you for having me back in the studio today.
It is always good to see you, and I'm so excited for this one because we've got somebody not only new here, but new in City Hall. We have Riverside's new Intergovernmental Relations Officer, Chekesha Gilliam. How are you?
I'm doing well, Steve. Thank you.
It's nice to have you here. Mayor, why don't you get us going?
I would love to, because I am ecstatic that we have Chekesha on board, and I'm just extremely happy that you chose Riverside, Chekesha, and wait till she tells you what she's about, because we really are very fortunate to have you land here with us. So, I don't know, why don't you tell everybody, you know, why you chose Riverside and why you decided to take this position?
Okay, well, I really liked the opportunity that presented here in Riverside. So, I spent about 18 years in the county of San Bernardino. I started there. I spent about 9 years in social services, doing client services and case management. I moved into policy and procedure development, doing program specialists and then legislative analysis. And then prior to coming to the city, I was a government relations analyst over there, doing board presentations, event coordination. And then I came over to the city because I saw it as a wonderful opportunity to advance the city's legislative agenda and the goals here. Just a wonderful place to come back to. I received my undergraduate degree at UC Riverside.
Oh. Go Highlanders.
Go Highlanders, yeah.
We can't miss an opportunity.
And then I also have my master's degree from National University in Public Administration and Organizational Leadership.
This is representing Riverside and UCR. I absolutely love it. So here's the thing. For somebody that's not in City Hall on a regular basis, myself, I'm not an employee of the city. When we talk about effective government services, how can an intergovernmental relations officer benefit the city in their goals and their efforts in that area?
So I think the position intergovernmental relations officer can help to facilitate effective conversations between our city council as well as our state and national leaders on legislative and budget matters that are going to be important to the city. We can also help to tell the city's unique story about the community and promote that at the city, the state, and the national level. And moreover, we'll be able to build those relationships that are going to be impactful to the city.
Yeah, I think that's the biggest thing, right, is there's so much going on in Washington, there's so much going on in Sacramento, and then, you know, we all have our different roles, and then you've got your local elected officials, right? So I think that's where Chekesha comes in. I mean, can you talk a little bit about that, how important it is to get us all on the same page working together?
Well, I think it's definitely going to be highly important for our elected officials to be on the same page as our local, state, and federal legislative delegation. We want to have our legislative goals and priorities aligned with our delegation's goals and priorities, essentially so that we can have a more effective regional impact. I think that that's going to be really important to move our legislative agenda forward so that we can have that regional impact. Now, that's not to say that we are going to be in agreement with everything that comes out of Washington or Sacramento, but more so that we have those lines of communication open and that it's consistent so that we can tell our story and move things forward.
Okay, so I'm going to ask a question that it could be hard to answer, but we didn't say it would be easy. Successful intergovernmental relations, what does that look like to you?
In my opinion, I think that looks like strategic networking. I think it looks like effective relationship building and consistent member engagement. I think it also includes planned, clear, concise, and targeted messaging. I think that it's to do that, we're going to have to build relationships that are based on mutual trust and respect, and that the people that are involved work collaboratively to move good public policy forward.
I had not met you before today, and I am so glad you are with Riverside, because that was so perfectly worded. Mayor, is there anything else you want to add?
Oh, I feel the same way, Steve, and I think it's important for matters of funding issues, policy. I mean, there's so many things we need our state and federal representatives to understand about our region in order that we can forward our agenda. So Chekesha's the perfect person for the job.
And again, representing Riverside, having gone through UCR and been in the area, I absolutely love that. Welcome to the city.
Thank you so much. I'm glad to be here. I look forward to adding value.
It is so nice to have you here. Mayor, always good to see you as well.
Thank you, Steve. Good to see you too.
And again, keep in mind, we've got four segments this month. For this segment, I want to thank our guest very, very much, City of Riverside's new Intergovernmental Relations Officer, Chekesha Gilliam. Always good. I hope you'll come back and join us.
Yes.
Perfect.
It may look peaceful, but there's a storm brewing. A deadly plant disease that can change our landscape forever. Spread by the Asian citrus psyllid Huanglongbing, or HLB, is a death sentence for citrus. The disease is already in our state. Now's the time to inspect your citrus trees and report suspicious symptoms. If HLB is not stopped, all citrus in California is at risk of disappearing. We must act now. Learn how to protect your citrus trees at californiacitrusthreat.org.
Hi, as always, welcome to Riverside Monthly. I'm Steve Brazel. Got a great show lined up for you this time around. In fact, all month long, we've got four great episodes for you. In this segment, we're going to be talking about the 2022 Quality of Life Survey. As always, I'm joined by the mayor, Mayor Patricia Locke Dawson. How are you?
I'm well, Steve. Thank you.
It is good to see you in person, although our guest is going back in time and is remote this time around. So I want to welcome the director for the Institute of Applied Research at California State University, San Bernardino, and a dear friend of mine, Dr. Barbara Sirotnik. How are you?
I'm doing great. Thank you so much for having me on.
It is wonderful to see you. We've got a lot of questions for you on this survey. Mayor, why don't you get us going?
Oh, thanks, Steve. And it's such a pleasure to meet you, Dr. Sirotnik. And I'm wondering if you could let our viewers know sort of what the value of a quality of life survey is to tracking trends over time and how people, what their thoughts are. Could you just talk about that a little bit?
Sure, not a problem. Well, there's an old saying that if you can't measure it, you can't improve it. Think about it. All of us at some time have gone on a diet, right? You've got to get on the scale and you're measuring to see how things are going, how things are progressing. Or if you play golf or some other sport, you always want to measure it. So we have data from 2013, 2016, 2019 from people that live in Riverside, but also people who work in Riverside but live elsewhere. And we've asked them, what do they think about the city and the services and the traffic and all of that good stuff? What we want to know is, have things improved or have things deteriorated? And we really need to start focusing a little bit more on that. Have initiatives worked? So that's why we want to do the quality of life survey. We've done it every 3 years just to sort of track how things are going over time.
See, I can imagine that something like this is so important to people in public office, not to mention businesses and everything else in and around the city. I am curious, information like what you gather through this survey, How, you know, when you're talking about changes in public perception on certain key issues, how can that be of value to people like the mayor, the council, the city government?
It's of value because you're changing what you're doing all the time to do the best for the city. Communities thrive and prosper when the economy is strong and when people enjoy a good quality of life. So we need to measure that quality of life, which means, are people healthy? Do they have family and friends? Do they have good jobs and financial stability? Do they appreciate the local services, or are the things that need to be tweaked over time? How's the housing situation and the environment? We need to see if, from the citizen's perspective, is the city prospering? That's basically it.
So, Dr. Sirotnik, I'm curious, how many people are going to be called for the sample? How many people in the city of Riverside? And, you know, what can they expect? And do you have any advice for anybody if they do get called?
Sure. Well, let me start off just by saying that nobody likes to be called during dinner. We know how people feel about phone surveys, right? But it's actually the most accurate representation of what people think that's around. I mean, think about it. If you get something in the mail, a survey in the mail, what happens to it? It ends up in the circular file, right? Or if you want to do a survey online, very often people don't have computers or they don't want to do a survey on their cell phone. Normally, people that do it online are either very, very strongly for or very strongly against something. So really, the best way of doing it is with a phone. It's random. It gives us a real good representation of people, all ages, all ethnicities, regions, etc. So what we're doing is we're targeting about 500 people, which, believe it or not, is consistent with some of the national surveys. It's 95% level of confidence and about plus or minus 4% in terms of margin of error. So what we're doing is we're calling weekdays from like 11 a.m. to 9 p.m. On Saturdays, we're going 10 to 6, and on Sunday from 11 to 7. And hopefully that will allow us to get feedback from a lot of different kind of people. But now, you asked for advice. What would I tell people? The answer is, answer the phone and give your opinion. I know how people feel about phone surveys, but do it and tell the interviewer what's going right in Riverside. What needs to be improved in Riverside? Because, I mean, your website talks about the need for community engagement and transparency. Well, the only way we're going to get all that is if people answer. So I would say it's going to take like 10 minutes of your time. Give the 10 minutes to the interviewer and say what you think.
You mentioned a couple of things there that I want to kind of unpack, but one of them in particular is say what you like about the city of Riverside, as well as the things that you think could be improved. And I think sharing the things that you're happy with is such a key part of that. The information that you're gathering, is there, you've mentioned a number of ways that it benefits, you know, people like the mayor or council and elected officials and city officials, businesses, et cetera. It also obviously benefits the people taking the survey. Are there any benefits we didn't discuss, A, and B, if people want to participate, is there a website that they can go to?
Absolutely. It's riversidesurvey.com. And definitely, if people want to participate, they can do that. I mean, think about it. Riverside has over 300,000 people. We're targeting 500 on the telephone. So it's really important for the community engagement aspect and getting the residents' views out to do this online survey if you have not been called. It's going to be available in both English and Spanish. The other thing that I would say about the online survey, the availability again at riversidesurvey.com, is that there's no way of calling people that work in Riverside but live elsewhere to find out what they think. I mean, they eat in restaurants, they go to festivals, they have feelings about the safety of Riverside and travel within the city and training the workforce, all of that other stuff, there needs to be a venue for them to respond and say what they think. I have to tell you that about a year ago, I did a survey at the High Desert. We had 13,000 responses from High Desert residents and workers. We can do better than that in Riverside. So the benefits are getting the impressions out, what people want, what people like and don't like. And I strongly believe that the city of Riverside is interested in hearing that and is poised to take action where they can take action. So I'm an optimist. What can I tell you?
What's the website again?
Riversidesurvey.com.
Okay.
So I'm curious, as a scientist, so people can go to the website and register their opinions there if they're not called. That doesn't mess up your statistics and your confidence intervals and all that stuff?
That's a good
question.
When
we're doing the analysis, we actually do the analysis of phone separately from the online.
Okay.
Again, we may end up getting a slightly different group of people to do it online. And that's why we also do the phone, which is the statistically valid way of doing it. Where both of the approaches dovetail, we've got something that we know absolutely is the case. Where they're a little different, then we have to start unpacking it a bit. But yeah, we're doing both.
That's great. That's you can just validate the online stuff with the phone. That's wonderful. That's a great approach.
I'm watching the scientist mind work. And it's wonderful from my side of the table watching this happen.
Yeah, that's great.
The 2022 Quality of Life Survey, you only do this every 3 years, so you definitely want to participate in this. If they call you, answer and share your opinions. Help us make the city of Riverside everything that it can be. And if not, if you live somewhere else and for some reason you're watching this as you're sitting in a restaurant somewhere and you're just passing through Riverside, again, go to the website. And again, the website is riversidesurvey.com. So thank you once again to our guest this time around, the director of the Institute of Applied Research at the Cal State University San Bernardino, Dr. Barbara Sorotnik. Doctor, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you so much for having me. I appreciate it.
And Mayor, always good to see you. Thank you. And I love watching your brain work on the statistics.
Well, and I just want to, thanks, Steve. I appreciate that. But I do want folks to know that as an elected person, I really look at these things. I do.
Right.
And so does our whole council. And so does our city management and leadership. So we really do. These things are meaningful to us. So please, please participate.
And this gives you information. So you'll get this now, since they only do it every 3 years, you'll get this information and you'll use this survey.
Right.
For planning the next 3 years until you get another survey.
Right. Exactly.
Yeah. So again, Riverside Monthly, make sure you check out each and every episode. I've enjoyed this one so much, and we've got three other ones for you. Check out each of them. I'm Steve Braslow, and we'll see you on the next show.